I'll just be grateful to play in a bin.
Evening, everyone. What a weird and unsettling few months it's been since we were last together. I hope that you're doing okay. But here we are, a brand new series of Midnight Chats starts right here. I'm Greg, and between my co-host Stuart and I, we're going to bring you 10 new episodes of the podcast over the coming weeks. In a small change to how we do things, they're going to be released on a Tuesday at midnight, so we'll be here keeping you company all the way through the autumn. If you're joining us for the first time, come on in, you are very welcome. Tap subscribe wherever you're listening to this and you'll get all of those new podcasts we're putting out. There are also now more than 90 archive conversations to get into. We've been doing this for a little while, so do take a scroll through those and hopefully you will find other episodes that you like. Loads planned for this series in terms of guests: Phoebe Bridgers, Matt Berninger from The National, Big Pig, Tim Burgess, Femi Colioso from Ezra Collective, and loads more others that we're going to be recording in the next few weeks. They're all on their way. Some special plans for our 100th episode that's coming up as well. But onto tonight's guests. They are Joe Tolbert and Mark Bowen from the band Idols. They released their eagerly anticipated third album, Ultra Mono, on September the 25th of this year, 2020. It was a day of record-breaking heat when I went to go and meet them in a slightly airless hotel boardroom in East London back in early August. Because of the COVID restrictions, they'd been holed up there all week doing photo shoots and videos and speaking to press, hence why the table we were sat at was strewn with empty coffee cups and sweets just to keep them going. They'd been doing a lot of talking, and I was the final one in before they were released back to freedom for the weekend. So much to talk about with them though, not least how they coped at home and with the band during the UK national lockdown due to coronavirus earlier this year. Lots of boxing and walking and Joe Wicks live streams by the sound of it. We talked a bit about how to navigate releasing a new album in the current circumstances, obviously all very weird and unusual. And we got into chatting about Jamie Cullum, he's on the album, Mike Skinner, Alan McGee, Jenny Beth, and lots of other interesting things and people that they've been working with. Check out the show notes for links to stuff we talked about, and also how you can get behind Midnight Chats if you are a fan of what we do. But here we go. It's a pleasure to be back with a new run of Midnight Chats. This is episode 94 with Idols. Before we get into it, this episode of Midnight Chats is kindly supported by Domino Records, who release loads of artists that we love, including past guest on the podcast, Georgia. Since she appeared on the podcast in May 2019, Georgia made the BBC Sound longlist, and her second album, Seeking Thrills, was nominated for the 2020 Mercury Prize. She's collaborated with Gorillaz on their current Song Machine project, remixed Jessie Ware's What's Your Pleasure, and reworked her own track, Feel It, with Young Baby Tate, co-produced by another past guest on the podcast, Toddler T. Of course, this all pales into comparison to the 8 out of 10 album review we gave Seeking Thrills at Loud and Quiet. A career highlight, I'm sure, for Georgia. So thank you to Domino for supporting our podcast. Georgia's live dates for April and May of 2021 can be found via the magic of internet search.
Midnight snacks.
Midnight. Midnight feasts.
Midnight snacks. Hi, I'm Joe from Marvel, and you're listening to Midnight Snacks.
I'm just pleased to see some other human beings, I'm going to be honest with you. Today is one of the first times that I've ventured out of my flat in 5 months. Got on public transport for the first time, which felt joyous, but also a little bit weird, scary. How are you both doing?
Yeah, good. We've been sat in different rooms with cycles of different people coming in and out, shaking our hands, high-fiving our crotches, and spreading germs all over the place. So we are well and truly de-cherried in the verses of COVID-19. But, I'm good. How are you?
It's a very convoluted, strange, bizarre answer. I'm good. it's kind of, this is new to us too. It's weird how doing things that were like completely normal to us now you feel completely novel, and it's a bit strange, and you feel kind of like the new kid at school. But it's slowly coming back, I think.
Yeah, I'm done with it all.
Promoting an album in the age of coronavirus, on a practical level, what's that been like?
All right, well, we just sat, like I said, we've just been in a room, and then people have come, like in the studio, and everyone's just, all the photographers have come to us, and then today we've just been in here all day, and wait for the journalists to come and ask me who Danny Nedelko is. But yeah, no, it's been fine. I'm one of those people, I'm not very big picture-y, like I keep forgetting. I think it's a protective thing, self-preservation, like I don't need to know just how fucked it is at the moment.
Mm.
Obviously I pay attention to the numbers and I'm concerned for the people around me and others, and whatever. But really, I think it's way more terrifying than I'm letting it on to be. I'm really scared of how idiotic people can be in the masses, just how fucking terrible this situation could get. But there's no point in thinking about it. There's nothing we can do. Just vote for Labour a few years ago. It's probably what we should do.
Take me back to sort of February, March time then. What did what's happened end up changing the schedule for you in any way? Were you mid plans and sort of down tools? Obviously went into lockdown the same as everybody else, but your circumstances, how did that change obviously overnight?
So I was in LA mixing the album when lockdowns were really kind of coming in across Europe and stuff like that, and I got off my flight the day before lockdown was announced here, and we just finished mixing the album. And actually our mastering engineer, this guy Bernie Grunman, who's, I think he's in his 80s, he might be in his 80s, so he's not supposed to be anywhere, but he managed to do us a favor and he drove in, snuck under cover of darkness, and mastered the album for us. So luckily we had it, we were done, we didn't have anything else to do with it. And then we had some serious conversations about, because all shows were just cancelled left, right and center. Festival season was slowly just dissipating away. And we just had some serious conversations about whether or not the album could be released without the kind of live setting that Idols kind of live in.
Yeah.
And whether we could handle waiting any longer. We didn't think we could. And we also felt that it was really appropriate for people to have something still to look forward to. You know, people have had everything taken away from them. Why take one more thing away from them? So we thought we'd give people an opportunity to have something to look forward to. We decided we were going to do things slightly differently. We were a lot more transparent with the release. We've told people when the singles are coming out, so they know that, Tuesday, the new Idol single. We've released more singles than we would normally for an album. It's been different, but in many ways, very similar. We're just not able to go out and show what this music is live, which is obviously where it lives. So it's got that bit, it's been kind of hard.
And obviously everybody's circumstance is different. Some people I know that when we all had to retreat into our personal bubbles at home for that, whatever it ended up being, 2.5 months or something. What was that like for you both, you know, spending all that time at home? What was that like, and what was your communication like with the rest of the band during that period?
Band-wise, it was pretty straightforward. Like, we all resided in the fact we just start a new album, utilise that downtime and have some kind of introspective writing, teach ourselves songwriting a bit more, and then, like, congregate once a week on a Zoom band meeting, all that shit. It was cool. It's all just seen as a challenge, and we understand our privilege and how lucky we are as a band that our album hadn't just been released, and that we can come back to touring at a later date and people are still buying our merchandise and all that. So we just kind of embraced it really and saw it as a healthy challenge, because it was for us. Very different for our friends' bands and other people we know, but for us it was okay. And then on a personal level, it's tough for me trying to, like, I didn't see my daughter for a bit, and then just getting my head around that. I obviously see her now.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that was a very bizarre time. But apart from the fatherhood side of things, like I've learned that I'm definitely an introvert and I enjoy my own company, and I started walking, which is something I really was never interested in, but it's really transformed my life.
Mm. I did something similar. I created a new routine quite quickly.
Mm.
And now that I'm out of that routine, I am really missing it. Like, I'm missing that sort of hour at least a day where I was like, oh yeah, but when I finish work, I go for a walk. Mm. And now I'm not doing that. I feel dislodged, disjointed, not quite sure what the word is.
Yeah, I think I'm definitely a creature of habit. Well, I definitely am. I just really, really embraced, in situations like this, where lots of people go through a huge shift in their life. For some, that's a massive loss, and for some, that's a massive gain, depending on their situation.
Mm.
For me, it was a loss of contact with my daughter, but a huge gain in downtime from touring and from everything. So I just saw that as a privilege, and it's like, well, if I'm not going to be with my daughter, I'm going to really put this to good use and do some work and go for walks and all sorts of stuff. So I really embraced it. I had to, really, for my own sanity.
Yeah. What about you, Bowen?
It was good. Like, I got to hang out with my daughter, conversely to Joe. It was, since we had finished touring in December, so I'd been kind of looking after her during the day whenever my wife works for 3 months already. So it just meant even more time with her. We've really developed a connection, which is great. And I've just, that's the thing I've got to focus on is the lucky aspect of this. You know, I, as a touring musician, I don't normally get to hang out with my family that much. So it was a real blessing to be able to be with her and see her grow up and stuff like that. It's amazing. But also, I also really miss live shows. I didn't realize how important it was for my mental health to perform.
Mm.
Okay, tell me a little bit more about that.
Both, like, physically, I actually, like, it's really weird. Like, during lockdown, I realized that, like, I need to, like, violently move every so often.
Right. So you weren't doing Joe Wicks every day?
Yeah, no, we actually did. Okay. We did do Joe Wicks quite a bit. But,
do
like,
you do Joe Wicks?
No. That's the kind of Essex lad.
Essex,
yeah. Susie loves it, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Your daughter, yeah.
But yeah, so
you need that physical, basically you need to get that energy out every day.
I try that with Frida.
Literally, like an animal, like I need to like lift something heavy and throw it, or like thrash about like I do on stage, and that gets that out of my system.
Mm.
So yeah, I really miss performing live. But so I've had to like, I exercise like 4 times a day. That's mad.
Wow.
Yeah.
How does that link to the, you mentioned on the mental health side of things as well. So that, did you feel a bit kind of agoraphobic, or not being able to go out and dispense that energy?
A little bit of agoraphobia, mainly like this kind of like pent up testosterone ragey thing. Mm. Like I just get angry at stuff. So it's really stupid. Like it is very animalistic, but I just need to like get that out of my system, and then I'm like the zen person that I normally am.
Yeah.
I know some people you could get it out on.
Not that way, Joe.
Okay.
Like, not, it's not aggressive, it's like just expend that energy.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, but
if you need any help with that,
Joe needs some people that need taken care of.
I got a punch bag.
Did you?
At the start, yeah, because I was boxing for like 6 months before it. So I've got a heavy bag, which is like about 50 kilograms, a bit lighter than 50 kilograms. Super heavy, sorry. Thinking,
That's a bit heavy, isn't it?
It's really.
It's a bit heavy.
It's so painful.
No broken wrists.
No, but honestly, for the first few weeks, it was like my wrists, like the next day, were really bad.
30 seconds and then done. You're like.
Well, that's, I did it the wrong way. I was doing like, I started with like eight rounds, and then I went up to 10 rounds.
Three like, minutes or 2 minutes?
It's on my app, I can tell you.
Here we go.
No, it's 3 minutes. 3 minute rounds.
Oh, that's intense.
It is.
No, it's stupid.
It is stupid.
Like,
yeah.
I'd only been doing it for 6 months before that. It's like a fucking stupid idea. Anyway, but I learned fast. It was 10 rounds.
And that helped as well, just expend some restless energy?
Yeah. I mean, I was doing it more just to know how to knock someone's head off if I needed to, rather than expend any. Don't have any pent up rage.
Joe often comes up against people that he might need to knock their head off, and
I live in a very dangerous place, and there's ninjas everywhere.
We're still talking about Bristol.
No, Cardiff, mate.
Oh, I lived in Cardiff. There's ninjas in Cardiff.
Yeah. No, it was. Yeah, it was more for exercise, the punch bag. It wasn't for expending or fighting or anything. It was just like a really good form of exercise. Because I find that I like to exercise well. I need to not know I'm exercising.
Right. Yeah.
So I've put little dots on the bag, and I focus on hitting that right and hitting it properly. Mm. Because if you hit something badly, your shoulder's out for a month, which I learned.
Quite literally learned the painful way.
Yeah, man.
When was the first time that the band got back together, you got in a room and you played music?
Oh my God, right. So that was three weeks ago.
Okay.
4 weeks ago, 3 weeks. Whenever lockdown was eased enough for us to be able to get in the room, we were in the very first day.
Okay.
We signed it. I was really taken aback. We sounded like a really terrible Idols cover band.
Right.
It was awful. I got scared. I was talking about it loads. My wife was like, "You're really talking about this a lot. You don't normally talk about this kind of thing a lot." And it was, so strange. Because a lot of our music, so say for example, take a song like Mother. We've been playing Mother for probably 4 years. And I haven't thought about how I play Mother for 3 years. Like I have no idea what I do with my hands. It's all feeling now. And so like I had to go back and learn it and like watch videos and go, that's where my hands are. Which is just mad and very disconcerting. Cause I thought we were gonna be able to come back in the room and the muscle memory would just kick in.
Mm.
And it really didn't. It was awful, so bad. And we were tired after like 20 minutes playing. We were like,
let's take a half time just to have some oranges, sit on the side for a moment.
The next 3 weeks are going to have to be real, because we've got Happy Road live sessions.
Mm-hmm.
It came back quick though.
It's the fitness though, I don't like, because we're doing three hour longs.
Yeah, it's going to be like a marathon.
Cool.
Or just, it's like going into the deep end. I think it would make for more interesting live sessions, because it would be a struggle.
Are you thinking about it? So last night, Mike Skinner did a Streets live show, and just because it was a live stream, just played with the format, like moved around. It was at Earth in London.
Mm-hmm.
There was like a stage set and moved around the venue and just kind of had fun with it, knowing that unfortunately you can be doing just a gig in front of people, but made the most of what it is. So when you're rehearsing, are you rehearsing like you're rehearsing for a gig, or are you rehearsing in your mind? You're like, I'm rehearsing kind of for like an extended, I don't know, almost like a TV performance.
It's not like TV performances are so weird, because for me it's like it's a gig. I'm going to picture the audience, those however many people have bought tickets, I don't know, a couple of thousand or whatever, and just picture them before I go in, and then just really focus on the music when I'm playing. Like, focus on the song and what they mean. Because it's a new thing, it's not like a live, it's not a gig, but you treat it like, right, you practice and practice and practice, and just be as momentary and present as possible by letting go. I think it's kind of to be as honest as possible with it, That's why we're doing it at Abbey Road and not venues, because we know it's not a gig, so we can make more of it with the recording, the sound, and the quality of that, and the venue being of interest. It's just more interesting for the ticket buyer. It's fucking, what it is a very strange clash of circumstance, which is a good challenge for us. Mm. I think like it's important that we've got something like that to kick us up the arse.
Mm. You said earlier, almost not thinking too much about the current situation. You're rehearsing for a couple of special live stream performances. Normally what would happen is Idols would go on tour for a year, 18 months, once you release a record. That's not going to happen for the moment. Have you allowed your mind to go there? Are you pessimistic about the idea of doing that at some stage? Optimistic at the moment? Have you even been thinking about it at all?
Have to, really, just because we need to know when. We always have six months onwards, so we've normally got 18 months planned ahead of us.
Mm-hmm.
It's been 12 months for quite a long time, but in the last year or two, it's been 18 months. Obviously, with changes here and there all the time, but it's just how we work. So yeah, we have to know.
Mm.
And that means like making difficult decisions that other bands might not. Like when we start a tour, obviously if you've got an 18-month plan, it's like trying to predict one of the most unpredictable times in human history.
Yeah.
At the behest and the cost of loads of your friends and their jobs. So it's very bizarre. We have to think, we're very conscientious, you know. People have faith in us, people spend money on us. We're a business as well as an art collective, so we need to be conscientious of that and do right by our people.
So as soon as it's safe to get back out there, you can't wait for that moment, presumably.
Yeah, it's like, it's there in our mind.
Fuck yeah.
But also, you know, we are thinking about things that we do still have control over, things we are still able to do. So we're focusing on writing and recording and getting things together for another album. But this, you know, we'll drop that as soon as we can. So if we find out we can go play Guatemala, we'll go play Guatemala if it's safe for us to do. So.
Would you be gutted if you didn't get the chance to tour Ultramono in the same way that you have done with the previous two albums?
We will.
You will?
We will.
You'll wait until the time is right. You wouldn't kind of say there's no gigs for another year, 18 months.
We'll tour it exactly as we would have before. It deserves it, and our audience will appreciate it. You know, it's like, that is one serious bottleneck ready to go off, in my opinion. We love playing live as much as people love going to see live music. So I think the marriage of that, when we are all allowed back into a room where there is no social fucking distancing, it's going to be insane.
Yeah. From a punter perspective, I mean, I'm not on stage like you guys are, but it does feel very odd to have been starved of that experience for getting on for 6 months now. So,
I mean, like, just things like, I was thinking about this the other day, I'm now really excited about going to see Proto Martyr's album at festivals. I'm really excited about seeing Girl Band's album, because they've also amazing live and have been disallowed those tours. And at the moment, like, those festivals where normally be like, oh yeah, I'll go and see them, everyone's going to be like, for the first time, if people are honest, festivals are fucking, you know, hard. They're a hard gig for artists, not for punters, but for artists, because it's not their show. It's like an away gig. It's not an away game, you know. But I think I'll just be grateful to play in a bin. Do you know what I mean? So like, I
first
think
show back.
I think the atmosphere backstage at festivals is going to be uncommonly electric. I think for the first time, it's going to, things like that, you know.
So excited, but it's so far away.
When I watched all the Glastonbury footage this year, that was a real, obviously my mind has gone back to thinking about shows a lot, but that particular weekend of just consuming all of the footage and all of the performances and stuff, and it all just, it was equal parts enjoyable and gutting not to have any of those events happening.
Yeah, but now the 50th anniversary of Glastonbury, we'll probably have Idols playing at it, so
there you go. That would be good.
You're welcome. That's a joke just for the listeners.
Thanks, Emily.
You're listening to Midnight Snacks.
This some is Viennese
light and buttery shortbread rings by Border, beautifully crafted biscuits. There are other snack companies out there, overpriced snack companies in hotels.
You've got some miniature Haribos there as well. So.
Oh, they're
and a couple of
Tang Fastics.
Yeah. Oh, there you go.
Is Haribo a snack?
Yeah.
Is it?
It's not a staple part of your diet, is it? It's a small treat, isn't it?
I call it a treat, yeah. Cheeky treats. I need a snack. That's not, I wouldn't go, I need a snack. Haribo's the place.
Is a snack normally savoury?
That's a good question. Well, a banana is a snack, is it not?
Yeah, I call banana snack.
So it's not a treat, is it? No.
Carrots are sweet.
I'd call Nutella on toast.
Balsamic dressing. Anya.
I want to ask you both about some of the projects that have happened since Joy, since the release of the last album, and stuff that's happened in the last few months. Joe, you got stuck into Bally TV. Have you wanted to do something like that for a long time, or was that idea born out of what's been going on the last few months?
Good question. I've wanted to do it for a while. Mm-hmm. Not Bally TV. Bally TV, yes, called Bally TV.
Yeah.
But I wanted to do something in between TFI Friday, The Tube, Shooting Stars, basically anything from the late 90s. And that, and also like Jules Holland, just all like, but predominantly be a music show where there's a live performance and then I chat to people afterwards. And mm-hmm. But it wouldn't look and be the same. Because obviously on Bally TV, it's just obviously remotely filmed and mm-hmm. remotely produced, and there's no live music and shit like that. But it's just a really nice start to my contribution to TV, really. Like, I just really I feel like, just like when I started Idols with Dev and Bowen, there's just no good music TV anymore. MTV doesn't have any fucking music on it. Mm, mm. And there's nothing real about reality TV and stuff, so it would be nice to just, again, just like I did, like we did with the band, is like just have a bit of a fairer representation of what real means, mm-hmm. and have interesting and interested conversations about music by musicians who actually are important to sanity rather than custom.
What have some of your favourite moments of that been so far?
Nadia from Pussy Riot. Just encountering her was great. She was scary and very chill, interesting. But talking to Kenny Beats and Kate Tempest and my friend Bobby was a beautiful time. Mm. Very, you know, because obviously I'm the mediator between different personalities, so they were all great. Every guest was interesting and interested, but when you're the mediator, so having a birthday party, you're the one who has the least fun. Everyone else is like, wee, cake, shit face, bye. Whereas the person who's having the birthday has the least fun, and it just felt like the Kate Tempest and Kenny Beats one, I didn't need to be there. I could just listen, stunning. And Bobby as well, my mate, Bobby Anderson. They were all just, it was a really beautiful combination of personalities that I was just like, oh, this is fascinating. And I just got more and more confident with it, and I knew who was on. Enough time to do some research and write my questions. I find that quite interesting, and quoting people back at them. You said this, and then they're like, oh yeah, I did. You're like, yeah. It's almost like I don't mind journalists.
Yeah, they're all right. When you get to know them, they're all right.
Some of them. But yeah, no, so it was just an interesting challenge. It was just something to do. But so yeah, the circumstance nudged me into doing something similar to what I've wanted to do for a while. But if I do it properly, you know, I think it would be better.
What about you, Bowen? You've got your project with Lee.
Yeah.
Have you enjoyed doing that, putting that together?
Yeah, it's been weird. We kind of, again, we all sat down as a band and talked about different things that we could do. Mm. Mainly have been talking about doing something like this for a while because we're very nerdy about gear, mm-hmm. like about guitar pedals, guitars, amplifiers and stuff like that. And there's a bit of a saturated market in those kind of shows, but they're all very instructional, a little bit dry, and just
so fucking dry.
but a little bit dry, but and also you don't really like, it's always someone playing
blues licks.
Yeah. Or like, you know, just not really getting the idea of why you would put pedals together, how it informs the creative process and stuff like that. So we decided to do this, and we were like, right, we'll get some guests on, kind of really get into their creative process. And we'd also use it as a way of kind of promoting Ultramono. We were going to talk about like different kind of sounds and different like the sound palette that we use for Ultramono and how we got that with our pedals and mm-hmm. guitars and the effects that we use and the amps and things like that. And then it just like, it slowly has descended into me and Lee just trying to outdo each other with really stupid stuff. So like, I cut my hair into a mullet and dug up my mum's back garden, just for this, like, really 1 minute of the TV show. My mum's sitting filming it, just going, look how stale I'm all in the background. It's very funny. And it's just been great. It's been really good to work with Lee like that. And the guests have been amazing. Like, we had Alan from Girl Band, and he just really, like, we got to learn a lot about his creative process and how he uses effects and pedals, because, like, he's one of, like, the best people in the world at doing that. Mm-hmm. And just things like, he was playing the song Lawman by Girl Band. Mm-hmm. I've been trying to work out how to play that for so long, and it turns out it's just him moving a pedal around. It's wild. I can't believe I've been so stupid. And then we had Kate LeBon. She was great, but she couldn't make, Alan could make noise, so we got Alan to kind of, like, record his pedals and lots of weird different bits of gear. She couldn't make noise, so what we did was we played Kate LeBon or Kate LeRong, and me and Lee had to try and imagine what Kate LeBon would use to make certain sounds off certain songs. That was funny. She was good sport. But yeah, that's been good. It's been weird. It's not like, I'd rather be doing gigs. Mm. I'd rather be playing shows. And
was it Kate LeBon or Kate LeRong?
Kate LeBon or Kate LeRong, yeah.
What was the other choice you came up with?
Kate LeBon or Kate LeNon, playing on the French thing.
Yeah, I would have gone with Non, absolutely. Now, in hindsight.
Yeah, but Kate LeRong kind of feels more wrong. Like, it is just,
Kate LeNon is like non-Kate LeBon.
Yeah.
So it works, doesn't it?
Luckily, we actually hissed them all. She was lying to us, just for the sake of.
What was she lying to you about?
Well, so she gave a thumbs up for all of them.
Yeah.
One of Lee's was nothing like it, like nothing like it. She was aghast. You could tell she was aghast.
But then said yes anyway.
Yeah. There was one.
Just to be polite, basically.
There was one bit as well where I was playing her song back to her, and she put her hands in her face, like she was inconsolable.
Oh.
and didn't move her hands from her face until a little while after I stopped playing.
Is it that bad?
I thought it was good, but she was just like, what is this?
She's a serious musician, by.
She is. She's also like one of my guitar heroes. I think she's like, her choices that she makes when she's playing guitar really inspire me.
Mm.
So a bit funny having that chat with her, really.
Speaking of guests, let's talk Ultramono and the people that you've collaborated with on the new record. Should we talk about Jamie Cullum?
Yes, please.
Yes, let's talk about, I always want to talk about Jamie Cullum.
So I approached him at the Mercury's, because he's a judge, and I said hello and we had a chat. He's really nice. Mm. I was a massive fan of his radio show. I never listened to his music, but I listened to his show a lot because I worked in a kitchen as a KP, and sous chef was like well into radio too.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved his show. I think he's great. I think he comes across really well, and again, interested and interesting. So yeah, we got on, and then he said, if you ever need piano on the album, let us know. And we were like, we do not need piano, but we definitely need Jamie Cullum. So we got him involved. He's supposed to be that signifier of working hard for what you love and everything that we're about, and that ignorance to kudos, that kind of, what I've been saying is that kudos is a bit like Stockholm syndrome, you know, like your captives you fall in love with, and really they only do you harm. Kudos is a bullshit currency in this city, and doesn't go as far in Bristol, I don't think, and we can see through it from a distance. Pretentious people and pompous people and obsession and wanting to be loved by bullies and cunts. So we wanted to get away from that and build an arena where people feel safe to be themselves instead of pretending to be others. And including Jamie Cullum on that should annoy those captors. It should annoy the bullies. It should annoy the assholes. And we love it. I think it's a great, great start to a very violent song. It's like a nice breather. It's like a little palate cleanser in the otherwise pretty full-on album.
Mm.
So it works for me. It's perfectly, both in sonics, it works perfectly, and in messaging and ethos.
Jenny Beth, Warren Ellis, David Yao also contributed to the album. How did it work with those guests, including Jamie? You recorded in Paris. Were they coming through the studio? Were they contributing remotely? How did it work? And why did you want to get those people involved?
And actually, Colin Webster from the band Sex Swing.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted him on early doors.
I forgot to say that in the last thing. I said it was only David Yao and Colin Webster were the two premeditated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, the others were more of a kind of a... Those are the people you went out actively wanted. You were like, I want you on this record. The others, it happened, it was
after
less.
After the recording.
Oh, okay.
Saxophone was in was present in the writing. We kind of... Mm-hmm. It was always there, like, this bit needs that timbre, that mm-hmm. tone. Massive fan of Sex Swing. Like, the kind of tones that he gets, the violence that's in them, and the kind of threat that he gets out of something that's kind of sexy and, mm-hmm. you know, it's cool. So, yeah, he was involved and he kind of came down to the studio, did everything in one afternoon and then kind of hung out for a bit. David Yao, I think we just knew he had to be on there, and he fitted the bill vocally, I think. On an album that doesn't have a lot of backing vocals, didn't feel like my voice or Dev's voice were appropriate.
Dev, I always write backing vocals with Dev or Byron in mind. It was nearly all Dev on this album, just because, I'm not a massive fan of your voice.
I don't like my voice either.
Yeah, but like, you know, I'm not a massive fan of Dev's either. It's just,
You work with what you got.
But yeah, I'm the same with me. I'm not a great singer, and some of the things I sing, I know you don't like either. It's like, but anyway, so with Deb, it's just he's losing his voice. He smokes too much, he drinks too much, and he's got a terrible singing technique. So at the time, we were like, do you know what would be much better than Dev? David Yao. You know, I wrote them with a better Dev in mind. So that's how that happened.
Yeah.
And what about Jenny?
Jenny Beth, we met up with her to do her TV show Echoes.
Yep.
And obviously I was friends with her before we met and stuff, and I stayed in contact with Jenny. So we were on the TV show and I was talking her through the album, and I said there's a song that's French, and she said it's terrible French, that's not how you say don't touch me. So I was like, oh fuck, panic. The engineer at the time, who was French, said it was the correct French. I said, is this right? And he said, yes. But what we thought I was asking was, do you like this? Or something like that. Something along those fucking lines. Anyway, he said yes, emphatically. I was like, sick. Turns out it was the wrong French. So I said, well, we can change it and you can just sing the chorus, because I wanted a female perspective on this song anyway. She was like, keep it bad French, because that's more honest. I was like, that's a very good point, especially in tune with what Ultramono is,
mm-hmm.
which is about self-acceptance. Bowen and I talked about having that female timbre and perspective for that song anyway, and it worked beautifully. She was perfect for it.
Yeah.
She was very, very forgiving to sing on that song in particular.
Bowen's got to leave now because he's got somewhere to be.
Got somewhere to go.
Yeah.
A man about down. Love you.
Cheers, Bowen. Before I ask you a few more questions about Ultramono, Mike Skinner and The Streets and your contribution to that record, what was the experience like of stepping out of the Idols collective of creating stuff and working with somebody like Mike Skinner?
Well, I mean, he sent the beat over. Obviously, it's like an album. It's an album of collaborations, so he had a couple of beats. So he sent the beats over, and it just sounded like our worlds of intertwined, because it was very similar to me. That song's quite similar, and what we wrote over the top of the beat was similar to what we were doing on Ultramono, so it just fit in the remit of what we were doing. I actually had some lyrics for it that I ended up using on Grounds.
Okay.
Because he changed his lyrics for it. He wrote some lyrics. We wrote the music on top of his beat in a studio in London, and then he wrote his lyrics on top. And they sent it back to me, because obviously at the hook, none of us are getting out of this life alive. So I was like, oh, sick, I'll use that. And I kind of weaved myself into the song. So I took the Grounds lyrics and wrote the rest of the song around it in the studio. But yeah, I mean, it was great. It's like working with one of my heroes. It's bizarre, but a relief, because he's a good guy.
Yeah.
And he's aligned with his strengths as an artist. He's like, that's what he's like in real life, which is a relief, I think, for me.
Was it an encouraging enough process to want to do some more of that stuff in the future? Or is it a case
of... What kind of stuff?
Or just like contributing to other people's records? And
oh, yeah, well, I've done a few now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll always do it. I'm like a yes guy.
Okay.
As long as it's not shit, of course. Or I'm busy. Like, Idols always comes first, mm-hmm. until it doesn't. But yeah, I love it. I like the challenge, because what I would like to do is to collaborate with different artists. I've just done one recently, actually, that was very different to what people know me as. But it's still me. And I feel like I should challenge myself with different genres and push my poeticism to a level where I can do whatever the fuck I want. And I will.
Every Idols album has been a reaction to the work that you've done before. How is Ultramono a reaction to Joy as an Act of Resistance?
It's entirely a reaction to Joy as an Act of Resistance. Ultramono came as a realization. I was just in a relapse of alcohol and drugs. I was very lost and sad and depressed and angry and stuff. So I had to kind of regroup and started. Ultramono is about the entirety of being in the now, in the present, and self-acceptance, and being a defense lawyer as well as the prosecution on your own past and present and future, and really, truly, you know, loving yourself in the moment. So with that in mind, it was it was written as a necessity to progress and survive that time where so many voices were reflecting on what Joy meant and who we were as a band to them at that point, what the album meant to them, whether it was good or not, you know. There isn't such a thing. There's good art, it's just, it's concise art, and there's true art, authentic art, and brilliant art, vibrant art. And we wanted to make all of that be true and vibrant and brilliant. And for us, that was at the time, learning to be as lucid, transparent, present in the moment as possible.
Mm.
So that's Ultramono was the phrase we came up with first,
mm-hmm.
and then we worked towards that artistically, and I worked towards that existentially, therapeutically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in the liner notes for the album, you talk about how maybe you found yourself straying a little bit away from not the vision or just the path that you wanted to be on, that those distractions, external elements had found their way in. So how did you...
Yeah.
What was your route to remaining present and focused?
Dissolution of ego, I guess. Because ego seems like it's about this inflated self, but what it is really is just relying on other people's reaction to you and what you think you are, instead of just being good or bad. It's just about being present. And yeah, it became a thing again, like it does every time something we put out happens. I'm so invested in our art and our music and lyrics. People were slagging off the music, but it feels like they're slagging me off and threatening my family.
Mm.
And it's about separating yourself from that and realizing it's bullshit, it doesn't matter. Mm. It's about the music, being, you can't be true and be obsessed with other people's opinions. The two don't correlate. So, I had to just realign, you know, regroup and be unified, accept all parts of myself in the moment,
mm-hmm.
to be true and to carry on.
One thing I wanted to ask about is something that you did, I can't remember if it was at the start of this year or the end of last year, the tour, the Q&A tour, where you're taking questions and answers from people that attended the events, basically just the people in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
How did you find that experience in terms of the types of things that people asked you? Effectively, people that are fans of the band, they came along, they had the chance to ask you anything. How is that different from the types of questions you normally get asked in the sort of standard setups of whether you're doing interviews for radio or TV or print or whatever, to then open yourself up to the questioning process of people who are fans of your band? Were they different types of questions? Did you get something else out of that doing that and that process?
Yeah, journalists wouldn't ever allow themselves to be vulnerable enough to play the card of, I don't know how this works, how does it work, you know? That's not what journalists do. they're like, for the sake of the reader, but you know, people are generally interested, and they're like, it's, I don't know what the questions are like. I can't really remember them.
I was just wondering if it, like, basically something different came out of that process and you were like, well, I'm refreshed because I don't normally get asked that type of thing. I don't know, maybe you didn't. Maybe they were the types of thing you were used to being asked.
Yeah, they are pretty similar. It's just the tone of the question is less assertive. I don't know. I genuinely can't remember any of the questions. I was very, like, just present and, you know, conversational. I don't like to try and be as honest as possible, so I don't really remember my answers. They're just like talking to me in a room, do you know what I mean? Like, I'm not gonna fucking embellish anything or lie or, but it felt really good. It felt really good. Like, I was worried that my ego would be inflated and it would be all like, so Joe, how do you write all these amazing songs? But it was none of that shit, but it was good. My ego was if anything deflated enough. It was good and hanging out with Alan McGee is also a huge privilege.
I'm looking forward to the Creation film that's coming soon.
Yeah, me too, because you know what, you can see he's like, I think he's a lethal thinker, that's the best way, you know. He's like, there's no fucking bullshit, but he knows what he's doing. You know, those people that just don't have to prove themselves but are very welcoming at the same time. Yeah, beautiful man. Really cool. Nice guy.
Final question is about, we talked a bit about, you know, divorcing the aspect of ego from the art that you create and just being in the band, whether that's like the reception of the album in terms of reviews or I guess things like sales and things like that. Looking upon what's going to happen with Ultra Mono, how will you measure the success of that? How will you be pleased by that being delivered to listeners? Or in a way, just by the fact that it's been created, is it kind of like, that's done now, I'm satisfied with it because it is what it is?
Yeah, I mean, I think we made this album at the perfect time in terms of COVID was going to happen either way. So yes, we couldn't have made an album about self-belief at a better time, because I don't need anyone to tell me what this album is. This album's a brilliant album because it sounds and says exactly what we set out to do a year ago. Like, we started writing it, I don't know when, but we wrote most of it within 3 months, just before we went into the studio, because we didn't have much time together in a room, because daughters and whatnot. And like, it is exactly what Bone and I set out to make. It sounds exactly like I imagined it to sound. And my lyrics are as potent and me as they should be and can be, it possibly can be. So I'm really happy with it. That is our success, but along the way, I will pay attention to things that are barometers of success in terms of everyone's knowledge of what that means. Like, I'll probably know more about record sales than I ever would have normally, because I'll just be touring, and it's something as a measurement. Like, what else do we have at the moment? But like, because of this situation, I'm going to make sure I pay less attention to that stuff as possible, because I don't think it's healthy in any sense of the word. I just think it's like best, like, it is what it is. Like, as far as, I don't feel pride on anything like that, but as far as happiness and contentness with the album, I am fully at peace with it, because it's brilliant.
Anyway, good night.